Hi everyone, welcome back to Simple Things. Today we're going to be looking at another very thought-provoking subject. So subscribe if you're new here, smash that like button, set your notification bell to all, and be prepared to share this video with a friend after watching, and leave me your honest comment in the comment section. Let's keep this text in mind before we get into the discourse.
They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us.
From the early stages of Adventism, there have been instances of inability to agree on doctrinal issues or disgruntlement with leadership, as is common in most organizations. Friends, I'm sure you're familiar with the term, the 1888 movement. If not, please do your own research, as history will repeat itself, as we're told in Ecclesiastes 1 verse 9. The things that have been is that which shall be, and that which is done is that which shall be done, and there is no new thing under the sun. Over the years, individuals have broken off from the organized Seventh-day Adventist Church, some forming their own ministries and garnering their own following. Terms such as offshoots, breakaways, or underground church have been coined to label these groups. The Seventh-day Adventist Reform Movement, Branch Davidian, Shepherd's Rod, Free SDA are some well-known groups which have broken ties with the General Conference and have subsequently earned such labels, fitting or not. More recently, ministries such as Save to Serve, Amazing Word, and Future for America, among a host of others, have emerged, having broken ties with the General Conference of the Seventh-day Adventist Church as well. Subsequently, labels have evolved and more acceptable terms such as independent ministries and self-supporting ministries are being used. Let me point out here that by breaking ties with the General Conference, I am in no way insinuating that these individuals or ministries were the at-fault party, as in several instances, they were either thrown out or banned by the General Conference and did not simply leave on their own. I mean, by now we're all too familiar with the recent case with Dr. Conrad Vine. I myself know of several individuals who have been disfellowshipped because their pastor or church board did not agree with their teachings and interpretations of Bible prophecy. But that's a whole different topic for another time. While my intention is not to label nor castigate any individual or ministry in this video, we'll take a look at the main reasons individuals or groups break ties with the General Conference. We'll also examine the definitions of the various classifications and allow you, my viewers and subscribers, to classify these ministries for yourself. Now, I did some prayerful research and found that the main reasons for breaking ties with the Seventh-day Adventist organization, on the other hand, are... Take a listen to this clip.
So you have those on the ultra-right. They're critics. They're skeptics of the church. They are looking for everything the church does wrong rather than getting involved in mission for Jesus. Then you got those on the ultra-left who are redefining the doctrines, redefining the prophetic message.
Firstly, desire for leadership and control. I'm sure you know of some individuals yourself who they have to take charge and take over, and nobody can lead them but God, and they don't agree with structure and that sort of thing. The second is their claim of new light. A prime example is Victor Hutef, who vehemently disagreed with the church's established interpretation of a particular passage of scripture. And this rapidly spiraled into what we know today as the Shepherd's Rod. And you can go and read up on that for yourself if you're not familiar with this. Thirdly, dissatisfaction with the conference and the way the church is being run. And this is very common. Even today, we see several individuals with the self-assumed responsibility as fixing things or fixing the conference.
Some people that think they are God's anointed prophetic voice today, that they got to correct leadership. There are some people that think that it's their role to set right everything that's wrong. I love the way Ellen White puts it. If matters need adjusting at the head of the work, God's going to attend to that. He's going to right every wrong. Let us have faith that God's going to carry the noble ship that bears the people of God safely into port.
Then there's the issue of money. And this is a very sore point. Needless to say, this is a major reason for breaking off from the organized church. There are individuals who disagree with the way the church is being run, are disgruntled with what the tithes are used for, or maybe they just think that they should not give their hard-earned money to the church. They believe in the doctrines of the church and are not interested in becoming a part of any other denomination. So they leave and start their own movement, still bearing the Adventist name. Then there's also individuals with their self-appointed role as the one who must weep between the porch and the altar to reform the church. I listen to many independent pastors, and man, this seems to be a key mission in that faction of Adventism. Here's a very appropriate quote from Sister Ellen G. White in Evangelism, page 318. It was and now is Satan's special work to lead men to feel that it is God's order to strike out for themselves and choose their own order independent of their brethren. Let's take a look at a few websites addressing the topic at hand. And this will perhaps help to make it clearer to us. Now, here we see that self-supporting ministries, for example, are ministries like the ASI, which is the Adventist Layman's Services and Industries. They are called self-supporting ministries because they are still governed by the precepts of the General Conference. They do not collect their own tithe, and they uphold the fundamental beliefs of the church. They have their own administration, but they merely complement the work of the official church goal. So these ministries are who we traditionally refer to as laymen. Then there's independent ministries. On the other hand, these operate totally independently of the conference. However, their leaders are generally, in fact, conference pastors. This means that they are free to disagree with the conference on policies in regards to things like women's ordination or the LGBT++ baptism, etc. But they still uphold the core beliefs of the church. But it's still not clear to me, do they collect their own tithe? Can they have their own church? Give me your feedback in the comment section if you have answers to this. So where does this leave ministries such as Save to Serve and others, which have their own church, collect their own tithe, print their own lesson guide and study material, etc., etc.? So friends, given this information, my question now is, are these ministries still the Seventh-day Adventist Church? Some, like Future for America, consider themselves a movement. Others, like Amazing Facts, are a self-supporting ministry. But others, like Save to Serve, who collect their own tithe, etc., do their own Sabbath school lesson guide and not the Universal Quarterly. How do we classify these? What are the identifying marks of the Seventh-day Adventist Church? The answer lies in the message. And friends, this begs a further question. If an independent ministry or a quote-unquote breakaway ministry bears the Seventh-day Adventist message, while a conference church does not even know the message, which is the true Seventh-day Adventist Church? I mean, more and more of our members will tell you, I don't miss one of Enrique's uploads Or I never understood such and such a topic until I listened to one of Enrique's video. That sort of a thing. I asked a similar question in my previous video, and one of these days it is my hope to assemble a panel and to host this discussion on a live stream. That should be interesting. I once had a pastor who told individuals not to study with me. I simply told him, well, if you were teaching the members and if you were preaching from the Bible, they would not have to come to me or any other member for that matter for Bible studies. You see the dilemma here, right? Friends, I am not in authority to provide the answers for these questions, nor do I claim to know the answers. This presentation is merely meant to evoke thought on the matter in light of the many distractions going on in Adventism currently. My exhortation again is not to lose sight of the goal. Let us not lose sight of the goal, which is salvation through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let's continue the dialogue as we study to show ourselves approved of God. Thanks so much for watching.